Welcome to a lesson on the transformations of the basic square root function. Let's start by reviewing our basic function f of x equals the square root of x. In blue we have the graph of the square root function, but if we wanted to determine actual coordinates of points on this graph, we would complete a table of values, and to do this, it would be convenient to select x values that were perfect squares. For example, 0 squared is equal to 0, 1 squared is equal to 1, 2 squared is equal to 4, 3 squared is equal to 9, 4 squared is equal to 16. And now to determine the corresponding y values, we'll perform substitution into the function. So when x is 0, y is equal to the square root of 0, or 0. When x is equal to 1, y is equal to the square root of 1, which is 1. When x is 4, y is equal to the square root of 4, or 2. When x is 9, y is equal to the square root of 9, or 3. And when x is 16, y is equal to the square root of 16, or 4. So here's the point 0, 0, here's the point 1, 1, here's the point 4, 2, and here's the point 9, 3. Of course, the point 16, 4 is off the screen. Now let's take a look at various transformations of this square root function. Let's first describe how g of x equals negative square root x and h of x equals the square root of negative x transforms the basic function f of x equals the square root of x. To do this, we'll look at an animation. Looking at our function here in red, notice if a is equal to 1, b is equal to 1, c is equal to 0, and d is equal to 0, we'd have the basic square root function, which we see here. To analyze g of x here, we'll change a to negative 1. So the basic square root function will be blue, and the transform function will be in red. Notice as we change a to negative 1, the red function is now a reflection across the x-axis. So the function g of x equals negative square root x changes the sign of the y-coordinates of the parent function to negative, producing a reflection across the x-axis. Now to see how h of x equals square root negative x transforms the parent function, we'll change b to negative 1. Notice when b is equal to negative 1, we now have a reflection across the y-axis. This negative in front of the x here changes the sign of all of the x-coordinates of the parent function, producing a reflection across the y-axis. So to summarize this, if y equals negative f of x, we have a reflection about the x-axis, which we have here in green, where g of x equals negative f of x, which is equal to negative square root x. And if y is equal to f of negative x, this reflects the function across the y-axis, which we have here in red. H of x equals f of negative x, which is equal to the square root of negative x. So here the effect is changing the sign of the x-coordinates of the parent function, and here the effect is changing the sign of the y-coordinates of the parent function. Now let's consider g of x equals the square root of x plus 2, and h of x equals the square root of x minus 2. Notice in this case, we'll be changing the value of d to plus 2 and minus 2. Notice as we change d to positive 2, the function is shifted up 2 units. And for h of x equals the square root of x minus 2, we'll change d to negative 2. Notice when d is equal to negative 2, the function is shifted down 2 units. So to summarize this, if we have y equals f of x plus d, where d is positive, the parent function will be shifted up d units, as we see here in green. G of x equals f of x plus 2 would be equal to the square root of x plus 2. And then if we have y equals f of x minus d, again where d is positive, we would have a shift of the function down d units, which in our case was h of x equals the square root of x minus 2, which is equal to the square root of x minus 2. Next, we'll consider g of x equals the square root of the quantity x plus 2. Notice how the plus 2 is underneath the square root now, and h of x equals the square root of the quantity x minus 2. Again, the minus 2 is underneath the square root. So to see how this affects the parent function, notice how now we'll be changing the value of c while b is equal to 1. So as we change c to positive 2, notice how now the function is shifted left. So when c is equal to positive 2, we have a horizontal shift left 2 units. And for h of x, we'll change c to negative 2. Notice how now the parent function has been shifted to the right. So again, let's go ahead and summarize this transformation. When y is equal to f of the quantity x plus c and c is positive, this will shift the parent function left c units, which we had here in green, g of x equals f of the quantity x plus 2, which is equal to the square root of the quantity x plus 2. And if y equals f of the quantity x minus c, again where c is positive, this will shift the graph right c units, where we had h of x equals f of the quantity x minus 2 equal to the square root of the quantity x minus 2. Now let's consider g of x equals 2 times the square root of x, and h of x equals 1/2 times the square root of x. So going back to our animation, we'll now change a to positive 2. Notice how when a is positive 2, the graph is stretched vertically because now every y-coordinate of the parent function is being multiplied by 2. So we call this a vertical stretch. And now for h of x equals 1/2 times the square root of x, we'll change a to 1/2. Or 0.5. This is called a vertical compression. Notice in this case, every y-coordinate of the parent function will be multiplied by 1/2, which is called a vertical compression. So again, to summarize, if we have y equals a times f of x, where a is greater than 1, this will stretch the graph of the function vertically by a factor of a, which we have here in green. And if we have y equals a times f of x, where a is between 0 and 1, we call this a vertical compression by a factor of a, which we have here for h of x. Now we have one more transformation to consider. Now we want to consider g of x equals the square root of 2x and h of x equals the square root of 1/2 x or 0.5x. Notice how now the constants are underneath the square root. So going back to our animation, we want to change the value of b to positive 2 for g of x and 0.5 for h of x. So as we change b to 2, this may appear to be a vertical stretch, but it's actually a horizontal compression. Notice how if we look at the function, x values that would be half of the parent function would produce the same outputs as the parent function. Therefore, we call this a horizontal compression, and it's by a factor of 1/2 the reciprocal of b. Now let's see what happens when we change b to 1/2. Again, this may appear to be a vertical compression, but notice how now, looking at our function, it would take x values that are twice the x values of the parent function to produce the same function values. So we call this a horizontal stretch, which again would be by a factor of the reciprocal of 0.5, which would be by a factor of 2. So this last transformation can be a little tricky. But to summarize, if we have y equals f of bx, where b is greater than 1, we'll have a horizontal compression by a factor of 1 over b, which we had here in green. And if we have y equals f of bx, where b is between 0 and 1, we have a horizontal stretch by a factor of 1 over b, which we had here in red. I hope you found this overview helpful. We will take a closer look at these transformations in the next several videos.